Hello, hello, everybody. It is 11:48 a.m. Central Time on the 4th of June, 2020. It's Thursday here in the United States. Hope you're doing well. And we've got some significant earthquake activity that's developed since my update last night. And if you didn't catch that, you can go over to YouTube and see the update we did last night. But let me turn on a display capture, and we'll just start over here in the West Pacific, where a new 6.4 to 6.5 earthquake has struck directly in our warned area at the Philippines North Indonesia border region. And 6.4, 6.5, we have to go back to yesterday, where there was a deep 5.7 down below the area here, just north of Java or north of Bali. So a new deep earthquake happened last night. That was the 5.7. And also a deep 4.2 up in Philippines. Now you'll notice the new 6.5 mid-range 6 has popped up directly in the middle area in between the two deep earthquakes. So this is a large earthquake in its own right, and that came on the heels of a 6.8, which struck on this side of the plate over at the Chile Bolivia border region. 6.8 here, 6.5 here, new deep earthquakes on both sides of the 6.5, and last night 5.5 came rolling in here at Ridgecrest, California. Pretty significant sized earthquake striking there. Also a series of fours and threes leading across all of California, as well as going up threes up next to Yellowstone, and threes going down into Oklahoma and Texas at the pumping operations. Now this is just a brief overview. Let's start here where our deep earthquakes are north of New Zealand and take a look, a closer look. We have a 5.9. Notice where the 5.9 is. The 5.9 6.0 earthquake is centered in between the middle point, rough middle point, between these two deep earthquakes far down below the plate. So we have a 6 in between two deep earthquakes here, and we have a 6 in between two deep earthquakes here. That's not a coincidence. Now when we look at this greater overall, you'll see it's like a V shape almost. If you were to connect these down to the core of the Earth, we have a V shape coming in right down below, let's say, North Australia, going up here into the Solomon Islands, and Eastern Papua New Guinea. Again, if you connect these earthquakes down through the center of the Earth, maybe a way we could do this is turn off the Earth and turn on our angles and get rid of the rest of the smaller earthquakes. You'll see it makes like a connection point down at the core of the Earth. Well, that connection point, that leverage point down below, new stress up above. So these are like lever arms, two lever arms lifting in on the underside of something. And there's going to be a lot of stress, which builds right here, over to here. Oh, hold on. When did that hit? No way. No way. No way. Cue up the Twilight Zone music, guys. We got a, at 14:18, this one just got put on the feed, though, within the last minute. Well, that's really weird. Okay, anyway, let's go up across our open area here. We have a giant open area where there's no earthquakes in the past 48 hours. That goes from our 6.5 and our deep earthquake here all the way off the coast of Japan. So the halfway point, if we go around the bends of the plate, brings us right in here into the South Ryukyu Islands, or right next to Taiwan. We have to watch Taiwan, as well as over here to the east, same distance apart, we would watch for something in the 6.0 range or upper 5 to be striking here and here on both sides. Why? 6.5 should spread out and lose energy going into the upper 5 range, striking the fulcrum points at either spot. Oh, hold on 1 second, guys. Just uno momento. Got a little issue here. Hold on. Sorry about that. Had to take care of something. I got a lot going on here in the house. Anyway, so going over to the west, coming out of Indonesia, we have a series of fours yesterday marked in red. And right here at the tip of Sumatra, we also have some activity. But there's a big open area here all across Sumatra going down into Java. The halfway point in Sumatra should also get hit by something in the upper 5 to low 6 range. this 6.5 is going to spread out to the north, and the energy is going to spread out also to the west, and we should see similar sized activity in the middle areas on both sides, to the north and to the west. The bigger activity, I think, should be coming back in here. It's more defined now at that middle fulcrum point. Going across China, no earthquakes. Going across Russia, 2 days ago, well, up here in North Siberia, Russia, you guys may have seen me get on and do a quick look up on these. I didn't talk, I just looked up each location. So the 4.9, nothing. There's nothing at the location. Let me go over to Google Earth and turn it on over in Russia. Show you what I'm talking about here. So the new earthquake in Russia, let me see if I still have my untitled path. There it is. Internal portion of the craton in Russia. And the 4.9, grabbing the coordinates, Olenyak, Russia. Copy the coordinates and paste them in. You'll see where it is on the edge of the interior portion of one of their cratons. So 4.9 here, right? Okay, now let's go over to the east. The other earthquake which struck, the 4.6, this matters. This really matters when you see what's at the other earthquake location, this one. So there's nothing at the one that I just looked up except for being on the edge of the craton. This one, though, look where it comes in. Well, you'll see a triangle there. You also see there's only two other Smithsonian triangles across the entire Russian Federation. So we are within 50 miles, 50 miles. I always look within 40 miles, but look at this thing. So let me turn off this little label mark here. There we are. This is right next to this. Balagan Taz. It's a single or solitary cinder cone, spatter cone, out here in Siberia. But I'm here to tell you where you've got one, there's more. And I went up to the north and I found another one that's just not marked by the Smithsonian. Pretty interesting. I put a question mark on it. There it is. That's a cinder cone that's erupted in the past. And they're right next to each other. You think the Smithsonian would have a mark on that. So there's two now, right? Well, that means there's more that goes down the range. Right down to this. This is obviously the remnants of an ancient bulging laccolith, a bulge in the plate where magma intrudes and causes a rise or a dome to form. So those are the two earthquakes reported. One right next to a volcano, the other on the edge of the Russian interior craton. But no other earthquakes across the whole Federation or China. How about a lack of reporting of earthquakes? That's more like it. One single 4.3 at the tip of our arrow. Iran getting hit. This is pretty interesting. The plate boundary. 5.1 on the south edge of the plate boundary. Let's show you the plate boundary so you can visualize this. Remember it in the future. See the thick red line here. Goes through south Iran, goes up into Turkey, then makes a W shape through the Mediterranean, east of Crete or west of Cyprus, then goes up into Italy, and out to the west all the way to the Mid-Atlantic Ridge at the Azores. Well, why does that matter? Look at the path and trajectory of the earthquakes. So, coming out of the Red Sea, down here, west of Saudi Arabia, and going up to Turkey, we have a big open area between this 4.0 and the earthquakes up here on the red line. That means South Israel or Egypt should also see an earthquake in the next day or two. Could go up into the 4.0 range. Why? Look at the plate boundary down here. So we have a new 4-point-something here. It's going to come up the plate boundary, the energy, and then go over to the west. But in between here and here, there's a fulcrum point that's going to break. Going over to the west, Crete got hit again, and that's the cluster of earthquakes here down on the arrow, and then a spread going around the Aegean Sea like a giant letter U shape. That's normal, somewhat normal. The Aegean Sea, we start to see it start to flex when energy comes in on the plate boundary just to the south. Again, this W shape here. When energy comes in here, this begins to move. Now, coming out of the Aegean Sea, again, Greece and Turkey, let's go back to where we have our arrows. You'll see, we've got three arrows. Well, one arrow has already been hit with a 4 going out and around the bend of the plate in Romania. then going up on the backside of the arrow up in Poland. And yesterday, man, yesterday, the USGS didn't report one of these earthquakes that happened yesterday in Europe. Not one of them. There was a 3 in the English Channel. There were 3s across France. There was 3s down in Spain. There were 4s over to the east. USGS not covering any of it. What a joke. So 3 here and 3 here and 3 here all across all of Europe yesterday. And now, well, now you see the leftover remnants of what took place yesterday. These are all European reported. Again, you go check the USGS, nada. So we're going to expect all that activity that was across Europe to pool up and new 5.0 activity to strike out here at Iceland going up to the North Pole. So we have to watch on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge next few days. Should light up. Going back across just really quick, let's touch on this. Africa, 4.6, and there's a volcanic chain that goes through here. Well, at least to the north. Let's go show it to you. Tanzania. Got some coffee from the Great Escape Coffee Company that came from this location, from this country. Incredible good stuff. Let's go look it up and see what's actually at the location, though. Southern Africa. There we go. Smithsonian place marks right next to it. What's this thing called? Hanang? Described as one of Pleistocene recent centers in the area, but not specifically described as recent. How about we just call it really, really old? And the other spatter cones that are around this, there's not just one. So one there, Kawarha is another one. Let's show you how many there are, though. They go in a chain back up to the north where they really are younger. They're marked in red. And it keeps going all the way to the north and meets up with the tip of Saudi Arabia or Yemen to the south. So that's, well, again, a location that's volcanic, isn't it? So recapping, new deep earthquakes. New 6.0, 5.9 centered between them yesterday. Then this morning, our warned location where we're looking for up to an 8. By the way, that's 1.6 magnitude off from what I'm looking. And a week late. I'll call it a miss. Even though it's directly on in the area. Even though it's a 6.4, we were looking for up to an upper 7, low 8. What did I say, upper 7? And instead we get a mid-range 6? Well, there it is. Can't win them all, guys. As we go across over into Central America, check it out. A series of 4s again across all of Central America, centered in El Salvador, our warned area. We warned the people in El Salvador 6 days ago and told them to watch to the start of this week. So here we are. We're at the start of this week. And here is the tiny country of El Salvador. So El Salvador has the predominance of the activity with a few 4s going out on the fracture zones down to the south. Over to the east, Dominican Republic was hit and Puerto Rico was hit again. So my Puerto Rican viewers, check it off the list, guys. You went up to 4.4. The highest I think we told you would go would be 5. So here we are, 4.4 and some other 4s and 3s. If you take the 4s and the 3s and add them all together, it equals upper 4. Now check it out. X marks the spot. Upper 4. Start of the week, 5.3. We can get that one out of there since that's the older one. Let's wait for this to refresh. But a new 4.9, upper 4 striking at the X here. And Mid-Atlantic Ridge also compensating on the other side to the north side of the X. But we are right on the southern arm of the letter X itself. Now, why does that matter? Look down here. 4.9 to 5.0 came in here, right next to the letter X, tip of the arrow. Trace the 5 or the 4.9 back to here, and look what we got. 4.8 to 4.9 coming in, a 5 up here, 5.0, and then the 6.8. So 6.8, 5.0, transferring out across the plate, down to the south, letter X, up to the north, letter X. Swarming in between at our warned area at Puerto Rico, our other warned area at El Salvador also being hit, and then an equal distance spacing of earthquakes going back up across Mexico. Now you're going to see something here. See the earthquake in Texas? See the earthquake off the coast of Mexico? See where the rings overlap? What would you do if I told you yesterday a 4.1 earthquake came in right here, right kind of right next to where the rings overlap? And, I mean, right here. And the USGS ignored the earthquake. They didn't report the 4.1. I had to go to the Europeans to get the information and the Mexicans because the USGS just chose not to report the earthquake. That's troubling. Again, look where the rings overlap. See how they overlap right here at the south arm or the western arm of South Texas? Let's show you what's there. So those of you who watched my update yesterday already know about this, but as we zoom in, we have this. These, the Christmas Mountains and the caldera here. There's a caldera. This is lava flow on the western side. These are volcanic buttes and the... Here's another one right here. That's a rising laccolith or a bulge. Same with that one. These are all old volcanoes there. And then this, the Manuel Benavides El Pinal. There it is, guys. We've got another large caldera there. And the 4.1 struck right here. And again, look where it is. It's on the southern arm of the western bend of Texas, Big Bend Desert. That's where the rings overlap. So when they ignore an earthquake, and I told you guys yesterday in my video, go give the USGS some crap for ignoring that earthquake. Well, now, there it is. It's the exact fulcrum point, the overlap point between our previous sets of earthquakes. Now, down here on the southern coast of Mexico, or the Baja California, that's a plate boundary. There's a crack in the plate right there. Maybe we can go back over to the USGS plate boundary map if we even have one open. And look this up. Just, you can open any USGS plate boundary map. It'll give it to you, the red lines here. And we go over to the United States and Mexico. So here is the plate boundary. The Christmas Mountains, we've got volcanic activity, seismically speaking, right there. Now, in between the two, up here in Texas, there are oil pumping operations up here by the tens of thousands, drill points that go down into the plate. So the halfway point between the plate boundary and the drill points got a 4.1 volcanic field yesterday. And this is why I take the time to look them all up. Man, when they start ignoring earthquakes, I know something's going on. Look at all these drill points, by the way. Here's a town. Here's what a town looks like, right? You see that's kind of an industrial area. And here's the drill points all around town. Here's the earthquake epicenter. And let's just zoom in on one of the nearby pads. I mean, it's kind of equidistantly spaced between all of these, wouldn't you say? What's the closest one, you think? Either this one or this one? Probably this one. Let's go see. There we go. Typical shadow of a jack of a pump of a well. Pipelines connected between drill points. And look how many there are. It just is insane. So here's a town again. Here's what a town looks like. And it goes through town. The oil pumps quite literally go through town. What is that, right next to a farm? Look how many drill points there are. Tens of thousands of them. I mean, look at... Let me get a sip of my coffee while you guys just ponder how many drill points are at this one single spot I've just randomly zoomed in on. There we are. And that's nothing. Believe it or not, that's low. What we just looked at here, here's the earthquake epicenter. This is a low number of drill points. There are whole counties where it's done, well, here, let me show you. There's whole counties where it's done like this, where there's like 4 and 5 drill points per pad. Look at the name of the town. Oil Center, New Mexico. Wonderful name. Absolutely creative. They got real creative with that. Now we go up into Oklahoma. I don't need to show it to you. Up in Oklahoma, it's the same thing as down in Texas. They're the same sized earthquakes almost, aren't they? Now, isn't that weird? There's a fulcrum point right here. South Oklahoma. Now didn't that just get hit a few days ago? I think it did. You don't see it on this screen, but it's small earthquake swarm broken out there, all in the 1.0 range. Going over on the West Coast, this is really where we get into the nitty-gritty, guys. 5.5 hit the exact warned location 6.5 days late. Right on it, almost 7 days exactly. So I issued the warning to be striking by the 28th of May, and here we are on June 3rd, last night, and it got hit by the exact magnitude. So we can check that one off the list. It's just running a little bit late. So what caused the delay? We'll look up to the north. Do you see the green 2.3? The green 2.3 is actually a swarm location. Let me pull the coordinates on the most recent earthquake here. Oh wait, a new 2.9 just struck it above Yellowstone's magma chamber. All right, okay, well, let's go look up the 2.3. Oh, of course, the Europeans have the information. That's not a problem. They tell us to get the info from the USGS, but doesn't matter. We're just lacking a decimal point from the Europeans, that's all. So let's go see what's there. I already know. We already had to look this up many times. Monte Cristo Hills Volcanic Center and Coaldale. Now, the earthquake swarm is struck in a parallel line from these two volcanoes right across through here. So the new earthquake striking right in the middle. Obviously, we're on the edge of Monte Cristo Hills Volcanic Center. Those are all old volcanoes. And we go over to the west, Mono Lake and the supervolcano Long Valley. They're all in the same shot. They're within 75 miles of each other. So if we get a big earthquake, 6.5, 7.0 earthquake, striking next to Yellowstone within 50 miles, we associate it with Yellowstone, right? Well, this is a supervolcano here. So even though the earthquake swarm is happening here at Monte Cristo Hills Volcanic Center, I will ultimately look over to the west at Long Valley to find the culprit. The magma chamber for the supervolcano. It's feeding all the areas around it. So let's look at it from a greater perspective. Turn off our borders and labels. And you know what? I'm going to probably need to turn off all my place marks. Let's see if that's going to work. There we go. So now looking at it, it just looks like landscape, I guess. But you know this is a supervolcano. You know this is a volcanic field. And you know this is a volcanic field. Now, I propose there's a magma chamber down below that feeds all of it. A general feeding point very far down below the plate that feeds the supervolcano, Mono Lake, and Monte Cristo Hills. Now, also, there's something else here. This ring of laccoliths. These are all dome bulges in the plate, some of which have ruptured in the past. This is called Black Dyke Mountain right here, and it's a type of volcano that can form. That's black basalt. That's not the only one. There's other types of lava flows that have happened here previously, either from deeper or more shallow. Some of them have never ruptured. They've just bulged. They're all about the same size. They make a ring. That ring shape is about the same size as the supervolcano, right? So a ring of laccoliths bulges in the plate from intruding magma here. Supervolcano here. Big volcanic field here with Pahoa Island coming out of the center of Mono Lake. And then the Monte Cristo Hills Volcanic Center in Coaldale. So these are all fed by something down below, I propose. Now, same time that's going on, up to the north, up in Idaho, new 4.0 activity coming in, and threes and twos. Take a look at it. So a big stack up in Idaho. Well, we've already talked about this. Idaho, up to the north, the magma chamber for Yellowstone starts at the surface up in Yellowstone Park. You know, where all the geysers are in Norris Geyser Basin, where everybody goes up there for traveling purposes. But going down about 30 kilometers into the crust and over at an angle, 11 Grand Canyon size magma chamber exists from the surface down below Idaho all the way over into Oregon. And that feeds Yellowstone, which means that the earthquake swarm is directly above the lowest part of the center of the magma chamber, which resides below Challis, Idaho, 30 kilometers down below or so. Earth-penetrating tomography, VLF, has been used to measure the magma chamber to find out that it's 11 Grand Canyons in size and that it goes this direction. So really, the magma chamber for Yellowstone's being displaced and the magma chamber for Long Valley's being displaced, causing earthquake swarms up above the magma chambers, not eruptions. Now, the same time that's going on, a spread is taking place going down through California. Ridgecrest. We go down here to Ridgecrest. Let's go show you what's there. The earthquake swarm coming in right here last night. They've changed the location ever so slightly. Let's go get the coordinates on this now. I think they moved it by 5 miles. They still have it in Searles Valley, but I mean, only really retentive people like me are going to really even care if they moved it by a few miles. There's where it is now. I mean, the difference again, it went from here to here. So, but what are we really looking at? Let's go turn my place marks back on. Look. Lava Mountains Volcanic Field, Pleistocene Ice Age Volcanic Field. But there's a line of earthquakes that goes back up to the north and connects up to here. It really, the line of earthquakes, let's show them to you. You see them. It's a diagonal line, equidistantly spaced, and the biggest cluster now is down here where the 5.5 is. Yesterday, the cluster was up on the north side, where this smaller group of threes is. Well, that smaller group of threes is coming in Kozo Volcanic Field. Kozo Volcanic Field's been drilled to get steam to turn all these turbines here at this place called Devil's Kitchen Geothermal Pumping Operation. Yeah. There it is. They named it, not me. So, starting at Devil's Kitchen, going down to the Lava Mountains. Now, there is a 3.9 down in the Mojave Desert.
Barstow, California. North of Barstow.
Guys, do you know what's out there? Let's show you. All these locations have something in common. I think you're going to be able to connect the dots here in about a second when I show you what's nearby. There we are. So what are these dome-like structures and mounds out here in the desert that are slightly discolored? These are small buttes, small spatter cones, like something you might see in Hawaii, for instance. But you'll see right next to it huge volcanoes, Black Mountain and Opal Mountain. Black Mountain, Opal Mountain, those are lava flows. On the north side of Barstow, here's Barstow. Here's Lavic Lake. Lavic Lake Volcanic Complex, including Pisgah Crater and Amboy Crater. Pisgah Crater, my viewers know about that. Don't get me going on that. That's a helicopter pad right there. You got a gold mine going on out here. You also got steam coming out of the ground. Steaming. Picked up on radar. Okay, so recapping. Super volcano moving at the California-Nevada border, going over to Monte Cristo Hills Volcanic Center. 4.3 and so forth, striking just to the west at Mono Lake. Swarming out above the magma chamber for Yellowstone. You know, I didn't look this one up. Hold on. This one, Sulfur Peak. Sulfur Peak, next to China Cap Butte and the Blackfoot Lava Mountains? Wait, Blackfoot Volcanic Center? Blackfoot something. Hold on. Memory here. Blackfoot Lava Field, of course. Blackfoot Lava Field. And we're right next to it. Sulfur Peak is right here. And all of these old volcanoes goes right down. Here's China Cap Butte, North Cone, and Cinder Island. An unnamed volcano. Somebody get out there, plant your flag on it. You can go name it. Dutch Butte number 20. Because I found so many over the course of the time online. So up above Yellowstone's magma chamber, down to the south at the Blackfoot Lava Field, the Texas oil pumping operations, the Oklahoma oil pumping operations, all getting hit. Then down to the south, here, the Christmas Mountains volcanic field getting hit. And over to the west, we haven't even talked about what's going on in California other than the super volcano and Ridgecrest. Let's go turn on the last 24 hours worth of earthquakes. This is going to show us everything small that people haven't felt, and they felt earthquakes as well. We need to look at the smaller events to see the areas that are moving and to determine what areas are likely to move next. Okay. So now you'll see we have added in a fair number of earthquakes. The frequency of small earthquakes is fairly significant, but across Oklahoma, for instance, a parallel line west to east, oil pump, oil pump, oil pump, oil pump, oil pump. The biggest earthquake right in the middle. You guys go look them up. Don't take my word for it. Go check. You'll see the oil pumps at each location. I'm not going to waste 10 minutes of our time looking up Oklahoma quakes. Now here in Utah, we are on the edge of the craton. And here in Utah, we are right next to the biggest pumping operation in Utah. Let me pull the coordinates. Sunnyside, Utah, negative 2.3 kilometer depth. We're up inside of a mountain. Or you could say we're up on top of a mountain, or right next to it. And let me show you what they've done. Biggest pumping operation in Utah. So right here, you won't see anything here right now because of the imagery date is 2015, a five-year-old imagery date. But I am here to tell you, all of this is drilled. And that's not an exaggeration. You might not see it at this level, so let me zoom in a little bit and start to show it to you. Now remember what we looked at down in Texas with all the little pads, thousands of them? Same thing going on here, but you'll notice the topography is mountainous. We're up in mountains. So that's why we're getting a negative kilometer depth earthquake. Look, two jacks right next to each other. Two pipelines, three tanks. The pipelines you can follow down the road to the next spot, and the next spot, and the next spot, where they've drilled and drilled and drilled. And all of these are drill points. Again, 5 years ago. Now they've opened this up big time for exploration, And look how far down to the south they go. I mean, they're just all over the place. So, down here to the south in Carbon County, all across where it says helper, right up to about here is the last imagery we have for them in doing their oil exploration. And this is as far as they went as of 5 years ago. And not that one. Hold on. This is as far as they went as 5 years ago. Okay, so we're real close. We're within a few miles. And anytime I see the biggest pumping operation numbering in tens of thousands, again, every one of these little pads is a different drill point. When you're doing that kind of drilling and that kind of extraction, when you get an earthquake swarm next to it, you have to associate it with the drill points. So what about down here? What about here? And what about here? Well, up here at South Salt Lake, BP mining facility in the ATK Orbital Systems bunker facilities. We've talked about that at length in previous updates. Not going to look that up. Down to the south, right in the middle of the arrow, volcanic field. Circleville, Utah. Okay, well, let's just go show you. I think we're right next to the Markagunt Plateau, or is it the Uinkaret Volcanic Field? Is it Markagunt? We're just west of Boulder Mountain. Okay. The Markagunt is actually just a little bit to the south down here. And let's zoom in and see how close we actually are. Circleville, Junction, Kingston, and Antimony. Uh-oh. You guys know about antimony, right? Okay, here's the Markagunt Plateau with its massive lava flows and dozens of volcanoes. All these black spots here are lava flows. That's not from forest fires, guys. Look at the flow on that. It was like a river heading down towards Panguitch Lake. Henry Knowles, this whole thing's a volcanic center. Going up to here, where you can see this flow down the mountainside. Look at this. So at some point in the past, this fissured out at the top of here. Broke in half, broke open, then lava, magma, came to the surface, flowed out, and left us black basalt all over the surface here, somewhat covered in trees. Same with right next to it. So that is definitely, definitely related to the volcanoes right next to it. So I'm glad we went and looked that up. Same with up to the north, the 1.7. Right here, south of Salt Lake. Let's go show you. There we are here, south of Salt Lake. Right here, Black Rock Desert, Fumarole Butte. The reason I take the time to look these all up, what do these all have in common? They're drill points or volcanoes? They're weak points in the plate. But the reason they're getting hit is because there's power coming into the plate from somewhere. And I'm getting to this. I'm building to it. Where is it coming from? If we have a diagonal line of earthquakes going from Utah back up to Montana, we have a diagonal line of earthquakes going across California, pointing back up to the northwest. I haven't even talked about the coast yet, but you can trace the line itself goes back up to here. It all points back up to here, to the northwest, Washington, Oregon. Now there's two earthquakes. Two. That's it? Oh, man. Well, let's go. Oh, wait. Wait a second. Boom. Got a case of Nitro Express. 18 tons of detonated steel. Over 18 tires that smoked and squealed. They had to ride her down or there'd be a big old hole where the little town used to be. Okay, so 1.0 explosion. Let's just go look it up. Maybe there is a quarry here. You know, I'm more curious about the other earthquake, though, the 1.4. Oh, another explosion! Boom! Kaboom! All right. Well, hey, we got to go look up these quarries here. They're quarrying the hell out of this place, I guess. What place are they quarrying? Wait, shouldn't it say quarry blast? If it's a quarry? Ah, you know, I'm not seeing a quarry here, guys. I'm seeing a river. I see a river. That's really interesting because we are on the north side of Mount St. Helens, or you could say we're on the south side of Mount Rainier. Well, that's odd. So, boom, down here on the river. I know, of course. I know what it is. See, this is a rural area. For the people who don't live in the United States, let me tell you something about rural United States. Out in the middle of nowhere, United States. We have people like myself who live out in rural areas. We call them rednecks. We call ourselves rednecks. Now, we don't actually call ourselves rednecks. Other people call us rednecks, but we abide by the term. Now, there's a thing called redneck fishing, where a person who's too lazy to go do actual fishing will take fireworks. And we know there's been a lot of fireworks in the news lately. They're probably taking their excess fireworks, because this is riot central up here in Northwest, up in Washington. They're probably taking their excess fireworks and dropping it in the water like a depth charge. Now, what that does is that creates a shockwave under the water that then stuns or sometimes even kills the fish, which then rise to the surface. And you go collect them all and you put them on a hook and you go home and say, look at how many I caught here. I did a great day. And you get praised as being the best fisherman, and all you got to do is drop an M80 in the lake or in the river. That's the redneck fishing going on there. That's what it is. It's got to be. Well, let's go up here on the north side. Carbonado. Almost thought it said Carbonero. I'm a little hungry. Put the coordinates in and go see this other explosion point. Maybe there is a quarry at this spot, but it should say quarry blast if it's a quarry. Again, guys, I'm just going to have to call it out like I see it here. We are on the edge of what looks like the ash. Yeah, that's the ash lahar flow from Mount Rainier. So we're about the same distance on both sides of Mount Rainier with two explosions. Now, I'll say that's not Bubba out there with an M80 doing redneck fishing. That's a lahar. Maybe it's Bigfoot. Of course. Sasquatch. Of course. Why did I not think of that? Okay. Well, let's be serious now for a second. It's two explosions on both sides of Mount Rainier. At the same time that we have activity going on over at Yellowstone's magma chamber, and we have big outbreaks going on down to the south, down at Ridgecrest, the volcanoes at Ridgecrest, and at the volcanoes at the California-Nevada border. How about going from the two explosions, boom and boom, or on both sides of Mount St. Helens, over to the magma chamber at Yellowstone? That's where the arrows go, and that's what's just been hit. So chances are it's an explosion down in the ground. Magma. Now, it's not harmonic tremors. It's not going to erupt. But an explosion down in the ground or up at the surface around the volcano. Maybe a small phreatic blast, a small steam explosion of some kind. That can happen. It totally could happen. People might not even see it. It might just be a few hundred feet wide. Down in Oregon, we don't have any earthquakes reported. Now, you know what? When I don't see earthquakes reported in Oregon, I get suspicious. I'm sorry. I do. Makes me think that they're not reporting earthquakes. Nobody can ever convince me that they are, you know, totally into science here. I've seen a lot of personal jabs and a bunch of BS from these people too. So let's just go look and see. For some reason, this isn't loading. Let's hit refresh. There we go. So looking here in the Northwest, we only have what? 12 little vibrations? The spots where the vibrations are happening, interesting, correspond with out in the Juan de Fuca fracture zone. This M-shaped fracture zone out here, or Z-shaped fracture zone out off the coast. So let's go back a day and see what was happening on the second. Zero. Let's go back to the first. 24 again. Now that's a little odd. 12 and 24? Huh. Are we working on factors of 12? Let's go back the day before that to the 31st. Zero again. Let's go back the day before that. Zero. Day before that. Six. Wow, we are working on factors of 6, 12, and 24. I'm going to call BS on that. That's starting to look like a computer program. 299 epicenters back on the 28th on my last update. So we went from 228 down to factors of 6. Yeah, all right. How about no earthquakes reported? Can we get back to that for a second? No earthquakes reported. Same time where the tremors stop. And the same time the tremors stop and the earthquakes stop, all of a sudden over to the east, we have a pickup. So it could be that energy is transferring out of the area and going over across the plate, or could also be that they're not reporting to us activity coming in from the northwest. I don't know which it is. If they weren't so shady, and I mean they are shady up here in the northwest, enough that it make you question, even if it was your just basic mathematics they're putting out, 2+2, I'd start to question if they were... If you knew what they did up here, guys, you would start to question too. So, I'll tell you the story someday about how they tried to stop science. Like, they tried to stop my research. They didn't even wait for me to pronounce what I was coming to my research on. They just tried to stop it. That's the people who ran the networks up here in the Northwest. So down here in Northern California, we get a 0.6 little microquake coming in out here. Mineral California. Now, I think there are minerals out here. I mean, when you see what's at the location, you'll know there's minerals here. But there's something else at the location, aside from minerals. How about this? We're at the foot of Mount Lassen. And these are lava flows coming off of Mount Lassen. Mount Lassen erupted about 100 years ago or so. Big blast. There it is. Mount Lassen at the foot base of Mount Lassen. So hold on a second. We got a small microquake at the base of Mount Lassen. We got two explosions on both sides of Mount Rainier. We've got a swarm above the deepest part of the magma chamber for Yellowstone. We got another little micro swarm up at the surface of Yellowstone. We get down here, the orbital systems bunker facility, the drill points and the volcanoes are getting hit across Utah. We go down to Texas, Christmas Hills Volcanic Center getting hit and drill points, and of course Oklahoma drill points getting hit. Mm-mm-mm. That all points back to up here where there's no earthquakes reported. None. Come on. So I would think that there would be a new earthquake that would strike out here out off the coast in the next few days again. Now, same time, okay, we'll get to that at the end of this update. Same time, we're still looking for this area. See this stack of quakes here at a place called Geysers and Anderson Springs, California. Depending on which earthquake you click on, it will either say Geysers, Anderson Springs, or Cobb, California. All three take you to the same volcano at Clear Lake. Now, humans have drilled into this volcano to get steam. So kind of like down in Southern California. And here we go. Here's geothermal turbines. Go back to pipelines. Pipelines go to the drill points. Drill points are where they extract the steam. Now, to get the steam, they actually pump sewage. Home sewage down into the ground. So right here, okay. Now down to the south, this is off the Hayward Fault and San Andreas, the 2.2. There's a halfway point between these two. It's the North Bay Area or South Napa. I had a warning going for Napa for up to 5.5, just like Ridgecrest. I said both would get hit. Ridgecrest just got hit last night, 6.5 days to 7 days late. That means, most likely, we also have to watch at Napa for an additional few days because it's taking just a little longer. But why? I don't know why. I'm going to have to figure out why is it taking longer? Well, when we're dealing with supervolcanoes, maybe I need to up my time frame by a few days. Either way, coming out of the Bay Area, going down to the south, the creeping section of the San Andreas, east of Monterey Bay, goes down to here, stops right next to Parkfield again. And, or San Ardo, but both are right on the San Andreas. Look at this. So here's the San Andreas. We normally stop right here on the red line. We're just a little west on the fault, but right off the plate boundary, here is where we stop. Yet once again, it's a regular occurrence to stop here. Why though? Why do we stop there regularly? Well, they call it the earthquake capital of North America, but down here, we stop right here because of what's next to this. The tens of thousands of drill points again, just like in Texas. Or just like in Utah. Look, all of these are drill points for oil and gas, and they've done it right up to the San Andreas. This is the San Andreas. Oil and drill points come right up to here. And we jump off the San Andreas and stop there where the drill points start. Drill points start here, go down and around, and end down here in a letter J shape. And look what picks up next to the tip of the letter J to the south. The biggest pumping operation in Southern California. Come on. Let's show it to you. Here. All of these are drill points. And they look like ants on the ground, don't they? Oil and gas. Every one of them. And it goes down to the south, across town. All of this. Through the fields. Down through the farm fields. And it carries on. So I told you, giant letter J shape starting here, going down and around. And the earthquakes come down to where the drill points start. And they pick back up where the drill points end. On the other side, super volcano. What about up to the north? We looked at Mount Lassen. What's right here in the middle of the valley? Let's go see. Willows, California. I remember that name. 26 kilometers down in the crust, though. So we're pretty far down. What could be here? Well, they don't drill that deep. I know that. Might be something else here. Something else that might catch your eye here in the middle of the valley. Are you looking at the screen? Sutter Buttes. Look at this volcano right in the middle of the valley. Sutter Buttes goes back to the Pleistocene Ice Age again. Pause it and read it if you need to. But look what they've done on the side of this volcano. They're doing geothermal, oil, and gas. I think just mainly gas, though. They are getting geothermal. These are all geothermal pads. Wastewater disposal, too. Oil and gas. And look, it goes down to the south. Goes right through the fields. Right across the river. And it goes up to the north, the drill points. Here's the earthquake epicenter. And these are all drill points up in here. Again. They're not getting water out of there, guys. So, volcano that's been drilled at geysers. Sutter Buttes volcano. And Lassen. Down to the south, San Andreas, going down to the drill points and stopping. Picking back up where the drill points cease. Over to the east, supervolcano. And down to Ridgecrest. Volcano. And it's a line of earthquakes. Going from volcanic center, Kozo Field, down to lava mountains. Over to the east into Nevada. We get down here. This, these three, all three are on the sides or perimeter of the nuke test sites. Rachel, Nevada. Now, they're not listed as explosions, are they? Bubba's not out there doing redneck fishing out there in the middle of the nuke test site. But they're also not doing nukes there now. These are way too small for any kind of nuclear. These are man-made faults in the plate, made by blasting. So here's the earthquake epicenter. You see where it says Raysand? All of this. Every one of these craters here is an underground nuke test site. And we can get the information on them. I show them all the time. They get hit when power comes in and charges the plate. U.S. nuke Operation Barbell S. October 16, 1964. 7 kilotons. There's so many of them here. Look how many. And the earthquake. Oh, by the way, here's Area 51. That's the famous Area 51 Groom Lake facility. On the north side of here, all of these, we did our nuke tests with the UK and France in the 1980s. And U.S. nuke Operation Chancellor. Undisclosed kilotons, probably in the hundreds of kilotons. September 1st, 1983. Just one of so many. I mean, there's U.S. nuke Operation Amarillo. June 27th, 89, 150 kilotons. Anyway, this whole area blasted to hell by humans creating man-made fault. And that's where the 1.4 is on the north side. South side, we get down next to Doomtown where they did the surface nuclear test blast and the 1.3 just to the west of the international test site of UK and France and US that I just showed you. So three sides, or like a triangle surrounding the area. So what about the 1.4 down here next to Las Vegas? Well, look. Get my coffee. So we've got a surface quake just north of the Air Force Base. I wonder, north of Nellis Air Force Base, isn't there something there that we should know about? Let's go take a look. I think there is. One of the biggest solar farms and electricity generation places in the area. Look at it. Look how much electricity they're generating for Las Vegas. Here's Nellis Air Force Base. But look, you start getting surface activity next to this. Maybe they used this to build military facilities. Who knows? But we don't have any volcanoes here nearby. And we're on the north side of Vegas. South side of Vegas, Enterprise, we have the Sloan Volcanic Field, which isn't even marked here. But north side, I don't know of anything marked. As far as I know, there's no volcanism here on the north side. Now, very far to the north there are, but, I mean, there could be. I mean, don't count me out. I mean, I might be wrong. I'd have to go look up the mountain names and find out. But let's see what this is. What is this? Oh, a shipping facility of some kind. No. A firing range.
Oh, no. We got Bubba out there again.
Yeah, I got my gun. I'm going. Boom! All right.
We're having too much fun.
Down to the south. Southern California. So we are focused in. Let me open up the largest cluster here and just show you where it's centered. See how it says Anza, California? This spot has been, quote unquote, slow slipping for 4 years. 4.5 years. Professionals announced 4.5 years ago that from Rancho Cucamonga all the way down to the border, right here west of Salton Sea, the plate was slipping in what is called a slow slip, where there are tremors, vibrations, as the plate slips. Now that's weird because up here, we were just talking about it up here, and there's like factors of 6, right? 6, 12, 24. Going back to my last update, 299. Tremors up here as the plate is shifting up here. So the plate is shifting and tremoring up here. We know that with the Wand of Fuca. But it's also shifting and tremoring down here, according to professionals. They said it would lead to a large earthquake eventually on a nearby fault. Well, nearby fault would be the Elsinore to the south. The San Jacinto is what it's on here. And this is the San Andreas and Imperial Fault to the north. So the earthquakes, though, are spread from the San Andreas and then a path of least resistance going down on the west side of Salton Sea and dead ending into the border down here. Let's show you what's at the border. Southern California. There is something that we're dead ending into. And this is just like all the other locations that I've showed you in this update. Whoops. Semicolon not understood by Google. Not a problem. Now we go down to Southern California. Look where we stop. Oh, it's a desert. Must not be anything there. Wrong. What are those? What are those? Those are geothermal pumping operations. Again, turbines. Now that's a solar farm right next to it. But geothermal heat coming out of the ground. All of these little pads are spots where they've drilled. And it goes up to the north where there's more at Brawley. More geothermal. So what's with all the heat? All the heat tied to Salton Sea Volcanic Buttes here, right at the south tip of Salton Sea. Now, just south of the border, the Mexicans have another version of Salton Sea. It's called Cerro Prieto. And they, too, are drilling into it to get steam to take to the turbines. So Mother Nature creates a weak point. We got a fault there, it's a weak point. A volcano there, it's a weak point. And then humans drill it, leading to a perforation in the plate that thus allows it to swarm and get hit when the plate is charged. The plate is charged from the northwest, where we don't have any earthquakes, and we're looking for something to strike out off the coast, but I swear they're not reporting earthquakes off the coast, man. Can't prove it, but my antenna is up, my radar is beeping, and it's just saying they're hiding earthquakes. Okay, now we go out here into the middle of the Pacific, and my Hawaiian viewers, well, if we needed any more proof that something was going on down at Lo'ihi, I think it's pretty much a done deal that there is something going on out in the ocean at Lo'ihi. Now, there's a 1.8 up in Mauna Loa and a 2.6 down at the foot of Lo'ihi. The rest of the activity right along the coast, and then zooming in, you'll see this makes a ring. Look at this. We're missing one earthquake right here at the foot of Mauna Loa, and that would make a perfect ring right around here, wouldn't it? The south tip of the island. But, hold on, let's go over to Hawaii and take a look. We got a ring going around where? We got a ring going around here. Compare. If this is Kilauea here, this is the foot of Mauna Loa, this is the top of Mauna Loa, and this is down along the coast, we got a ring going around here. And that to me says Lo'ihi. There's something going on out here. And we already have big craters out here. There's been underwater flows that have happened before. It's rising off the sea floor. It's got about how many thousand feet? It's got about 4,000 feet, no, 3,500 feet left to go before it comes up above sea level. But it is rising. So likely, the Middle East Rift Zone here is charging, thus displacing out to the west over into Lo'ihi. And the outbreak might come out in the ocean, which would be awesome if it flows instead of blows, and it comes out in the ocean instead of on land. But that would then rob Kilauea pretty much forever. It would put Kilauea into a mode where it's secondary to the activity at Lo'ihi, and that Lo'ihi would be the new focus point like Kilauea used to be. Now, I was wrong last year. I told everybody 1 year I would watch for a year, and that within about a year, we would start to see some activity that could lead to Kilauea coming back in the Middle East Rift Zone. And instead, 1 year and 4 months in, so just over a year in, this starts to take place here on the edge of the Middle East Rift Zone. Again, let's look at Hawaii at an angle. There, now we're coming in on Hawaii at an angle. This might help you to understand a little better. So now here's Mauna Loa, here's Kilauea, and here's the Hawaii Volcanoes National Park, and down here is Lo'ihi out off the coast. So lowest, middle, highest, and then of course Mauna Kea back behind it all. But this is the Middle East Rift Zone that's feeding, or the magma chamber is, feeding Kilauea up above. And this thing drained out last year down to water level, all the way over. It was full, and then drained, and it collapsed, and it pushed down. It pushed down on the magma chamber. When it pushed down on the magma chamber, flowed out at its lowest point down here. And it went down to the ocean. So when it reached that equilibrium point, where the break was down here, and the lava flowed down and came out, it then started to refill and recharge. That was a year and a half ago. But this thing's a few thousand feet smaller inside. It collapsed on the top. The top has lowered. So the magma chamber's smaller now. And as it started to recharge and refill, it's now been displaced out to the side. Since the top has collapsed in, makes sense. Top pressing down, it's going to press out to the sides. One side outbreak, whatever. Over here, huge lava flow last year. Doesn't it stand to reason that same thing could happen over here? Now, I don't think that's happening yet. It's bulging and deforming, and that's what's causing the seismic activity. It will lead to that at some point, I think. Let's go back and turn back on our 7-day feed. Look at the last 7 days, and we'll wrap this up. Deep earthquakes happening around the West Pacific. Big earthquake activity in our warned area. 1.5 to 1.6 magnitude under what we are looking for. What's going on here? Hey! Ah! Oui! A 3.0 has struck. Tremblement de terre! Oh, man. I don't speak French. But I do say, this is on the coast of Normandy! 3.0. Same size that struck over to the east, over in Romania. And 3.0 struck down here off the coast of, or on the coast of Spain. So isn't that three same-sized earthquakes, equal distantly spaced, across the edge of all Europe in the last 12 hours? Not even, in the last 8 hours? Three. And look where the rings bisect each other. North Germany, Holland border, Denmark, and here, right next to the Pyrenees or South France. Amazing, man. It's amazing. I can't believe professionals didn't notice this. Serious. That there was an equal distance spacing of earthquakes happening across land masses and they somehow missed it? Dude, What? And that they tried to shut me down for noticing it? Oh, man, that's even more suspect. That makes me start to think that they knew. They're like, we don't want to reprint all these textbooks. Are you kidding me? We've been teaching for 200 years that there's no relation between. We're not going to change this shit. And then next thing you know, I come along online. Hey, guys, look, there's some progression of earthquakes. And they're like, shut them down. Okay, so Ridgecrest has been hit with the expected earthquake. We forecast for a 5.5. 5.5 is hit. 6 days late. Check it off the list. 6 days late on something that people said was impossible, by the way. Then, here, West Pacific, exact spot, again, one magnitude, 1.5 magnitude, under expected. Again, hitting the spot where people said it was impossible to forecast. 6 days late, 7 days late. And we're looking for Napa to come in here in Northern California. And I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, don't fault me if I'm warning Napa and it comes in right along the coast at Eureka. We try to get it within 200 miles. But come on, there it is. Europe just got hit with an equal distance spread of the same sized earthquakes in the last 8 hours. Another way to look at that is, how much energy do you think it would take to displace all of Europe on a 3.0 basis in 8 hours' time? It would take a lot of power, take a big push, which means down to the south, Italy, Greece, Mediterranean, charged, majorly charged right now. As a matter of fact, you should probably watch the Mediterranean. I didn't issue a forecast for this, but come on, all of Europe's getting pushed right now. Probably should watch the Mediterranean for a new release. Where? In between our sets of earthquakes, fulcrum point. But that gets into another update entirely. This is a good time for you to develop an earthquake plan. And it's so basic. You're going to have a place inside that you take shelter if it's a smaller earthquake. If it's a mega quake or you don't feel confident in your structure, you also need to have a pre-designated area outside that you're going to go to. Make sure your friends and family and loved ones, you guys all know where to go. Make sure it's away from things outside. You don't want to go outside into a worse situation of falling material that you could have just been underneath a table or a desk inside and ridden out the earthquake. So know your surroundings, know where you're going to go. And if you go outside, you might not be coming back in for a while. Could be hours, could be days. So you need to have an emergency kit. The emergency kit is a bag that you keep somewhere nearby the door you're going to go out. And you grab it, has a change of clothes, set of shoes, food and water for a few days, communication, flashlight, first aid, sanitation. Just those basic needs. And have it somewhere easily accessible. And again, you make sure your friends, family, loved ones, people you live with, know where it is too in case they have to grab it. Don't make it too heavy. Again, this is just for the first couple days. Long-term supplies are entirely different. We're not talking about that. We're just talking about for the first couple days. And you'll be way better off than everybody else because most people don't even want to know or pay attention to the seismic activity. They certainly don't want to hear that it's coming at them like a river. I thought people did. I thought the general population wanted to know when an earthquake's coming. It turns out they just want to say that they don't want to know or that you can't know. When you start to tell them, they freak, even if it's small earthquake activity. So we're going to remove the fear from earthquakes and we're going to replace it with vigilance, like severe weather. It's okay to be intimidated by severe weather. I mean, it's tornadoes and hail and those kind of things, but we don't live in fear of them. Right? You don't shut down the weather forecaster for telling you that a storm is possibly going to be coming. You want to know that information, you file it away in the back of your head, you go about your day. And that's the same thing I want you to start doing with earthquakes. Okay? I'll be back if anything else big goes down. We'll save this as a video, we'll upload it over on YouTube, premiere it over there. I'm looking for a new 5.5 to come into Napa, and a new earthquake, could even be bigger, out off the coast in the ocean. The Northwest United States. West Pacific, whole different story. We're going to look for 6.0 activity up near Taiwan, South Japan, Ryukyu Islands. We're also going to look for 6.0 level activity to go over into Sumatra, Java, Indonesia. Might as well just get this on the map here now. We'll watch South Europe again for something in the six-ish range between our sets of quakes between Greece and Italy. Upper five, low six. So it looks like a set of sixes, a round of sixes, is going to be spreading out now. And it's nothing to play around with. Be safe. You know what? Let's end this on a very, very nice note. Do you like what I'm doing? If you like what I'm doing, please feel free to come over to my Twitch channel. Yes, if you're watching on YouTube, you can come over to Twitch and watch my 24/7 stream over on Twitch. You don't even have to be a member. You can just watch it. Now, if you want to get into the chat room and do some other stuff, you do have to become a subscriber. If you have Amazon Prime, which I know tens of thousands of my viewers do, you guys can get a free membership over on Twitch. It comes with your Amazon Prime. You might not know that. You just click a button and it subscribes you up. If you don't have Amazon Prime, you can still watch, and I will upload my videos to YouTube if it's important, obviously. Okay, word up, much love. I'll be back. Peace out.